Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to TradeStation. My name is Michael Burke. I head up client education here at TradeStation. I want to welcome you to another edition of our options trading series. And today's event, which is options trading, looking at option symbols, quotes, and chains, will be hosted by Ed Modla of the OIC. And we'll get to Ed in just a minute. Keep in mind that the following presentation is for educational purposes only. All of the symbols and trading ideas discussed by the instructor are for demonstration purposes and are not recommendations. Active trading is not suitable for everyone. Options trading carries a high degree of risk. You can find additional disclosure information on the TradeStation website. If you're looking to get up to speed on the TradeStation platform, TradeStation Securities is hosting a daily training channel, Getting Started with TradeStation, on the youcantrade.com website. Every day there's something new to learn. You can ask questions, watch videos, there's quick start guides, everything you need to know to get up and running with TradeStation quickly. And it's all for free. So just visit us at youcantrade.com/channels/getting-started-with-TradeStation. And if you've been with TradeStation for a little while and you want to take TradeStation to that next level, consider Masterclass. So Masterclass is our online advanced deep dive training for all things TradeStation. There's daily events. You can ask questions to experts on TradeStation. There are courses for strategy trading and easy language. This is based on our live in-person Masterclass that was so popular for quite a long time before all of these things hit us. And you get all the same great resources and events. And if it's something that you think you might be interested, you can try check it out for 14 days for free on a trial. And it's just $59 a month after that. But there's so much to look at there. Lots of great resources. So please check it out. Just a reminder, we are recording this event as we do all of our events, and you can view some of the previous sessions with Ed Modla on our YouTube channel. Just visit YouTube TradeStation on YouTube and look for the options event playlist, and you can watch all of the great events that Ed has done over the course of the last couple of years, in fact. So as I said, Ed Modla is with us today. He's our host. He's the Director of Retail Education and Business Development at the Options Industry Council. Ed is an expert in all things options, and it is just awesome to have him here with us. And I'm gonna turn it over to you, Ed.
Thank you very much, Michael. Always good to be here. And I'll just get my screen shared as I go through the topic here. As Michael said, symbols, quotes, and chains, a little bit of a different topic from what you might see. This isn't strategies or core concepts or some of the things that Greeks, this is gonna be a little bit of bouncing around to different topics here. And it looks like maybe my screen share, I'm getting a pop-up here. You can't start all the other participants. Let me try this again. Okay, here we go. So like I said, this topic is not your traditional options core concepts or basics or strategies. Gonna bounce around, and really this came together as a collage from questions that I frequently have received over the months and years, and putting them together into an outline of information that you may come across sometimes or rarely or frequently. You might gloss over these things because you don't understand them, and this is just an attempt to answer some of those questions. A little bit about myself: coming from the trading floors in the late 90s, I was an options market maker for a few large professional trading firms on the floors in Chicago and New York, traded online for a number of years. And for the last over 5 years, about 5.5 years now, I've been giving education for the Options Industry Council, live presentations, online presentations, all centered around the options product. Here's our disclaimer. Options are certainly a unique and complex tool that deserve full and complete understanding before using them in a live account. And our outline today, symbology is going to be rather interesting, some of the history there and how it developed over time. And then I'll go through the beginning a little bit more quickly with symbology and cycles, and then spend more time digging deeper into chains and quotes and some things you might see when you're looking at your options chains, bid-ask spreads, volume, open interest. And I'll close it up with some comments about contract adjustments, which occur from time to time, and you might be witnessing some contract adjustments recently that have occurred because of reverse splits. Some of these energy ETFs that have needed to do reverse splits recently have resulted in contract adjustments, and I'll just have a few words to say and what to look out for there without getting into too much detail. Before I get to symbology, just a few words about the industry and starting off with some data. Now, prior to 1973, options were trading. Options have been around for a long time, but never in the listed capacity. So before 1973, if you wanted to trade an options contract, an investor would contact their broker, who then had to find the counterparty. And if you were able to negotiate a price and execute a trade, you were tied to that counterparty. Now, listed options changed all of that. Oh, CBOE back in 1973, listing options contracts that could be traded and became fungible because they were traded on an exchange and cleared by OCC. There were only 16 companies that had options back then in 73, all call options at the time. The SEC took some years before they were comfortable allowing put options to be traded. So it was about 4 years later that put options came on the board, but started there with 16 companies. Fast forward to today, well up over 4,000 that have listed options. And one myth that I frequently like to point out and dispel is, you know, what happens to options once they're open? There is a myth that circulates quite widely, and I hear from investors that most options expire worthless. And data shows something different. For open positions, OCC data has consistently shown year after year that about 70% are closed before ever reaching expiration. And the profitability of those is really impossible to determine. You'd have to know both the entry point price and the exit price. The point here is just that 70% are closed. 20% are held through expiration and unexercised, or you might say expire worthless. That's 20%. And the other roughly 10% are exercised at some point, whether it's early or at expiration, another 10% are exercised. Now, that myth, I believe, comes from ignoring that 70% number of all options that are closed and just looking at the rest and saying, well, out of this rest of 30%, maybe 2/3, or maybe it's more, expire worthless. Of the options held through expiration, the vast majority do expire worthless, which makes sense because if you didn't get a chance to sell it before expiration and close it, that probably means there might not be worth anything. There's no value there. So most options, held through expiration and unexercised, you know, that's the worthless part, 20%. So just some interesting data from the OCC. And the OCC's got a lot of data on their website. A few references that you might find interesting at the OCC's website, simply theocc.com. There is a market data section where you can then further drill down to their series and trading data page. And there's a lot of different studies that you can look at and searches you can do on this series and trading data page. But a couple of them to highlight, first of all, directory of listed products. This will list every symbol, trading symbol that has options. And it'll include the option symbol, the company name, which exchanges list those contracts, and the position limit. The position limit is is identified as a share count. So if you're looking for the options position limit, divide that by 100, and you have position limits included there. One thing about the exchanges, you'll notice, first of all, not all companies have options. The exchanges have discretion to decide for themselves if they would like to list options on a particular company. They go through some criteria and general rules that would include, for example, the share price being at least $3 a share, the shares trading on a national exchange. I believe there needs to be at least 7 million shares in float and 2,000 unique shareholders outside of insiders. Those are just some of the criteria that the exchanges will look at. And then independently, the exchanges will decide if they want to list options. Of course, the heavily traded names are listed on all exchanges, but some other names are only listed on one or two or a subset. So you'll have that list identified for you here. And then you can also do a series search, drilling down even further into a specific symbol to find the list of available series or the expiration dates and the strike prices for a particular underlying symbol. And that will include adjusted and flex. And I'll have some words to say about adjusted and flex and with respect to symbology, how you identify those. But that's just some of the things you can get on the OCC's website, including some other data points you might find interesting. New listings you can check for, maybe an IPO that comes out and you're wondering, have options been listed on this yet? You will see, of course, this is a lagging indicator. Once they've been listed, they'll show up here and you can see what options have been listed on entities that maybe be IPOs or maybe they started to increase in volume, along with a whole bunch of other information here in this series and trading data section on the OIC website, our OCC website. OCC owns OIC, and their website has plenty of data on it. So now let's start to get into options symbology. Back in 2010, the industry created a more unified approach towards what an option symbol should look like. Now, still, there are variations within trading platforms and from one broker to the next, but the important information needs to be included. And of course, it's very important to understand your platform. And when you read a symbol, what does it tell you? You might see something that looks like this. And this comes from the OIC's website and the quotes that we have. You might look at this and not quite understand what it is. And your trading platform is going to have all the key components in some fashion and organize them in some particular way. And you just need to know what that is. All of the key components need to be there. In this case, you have the stock symbol XYZ. And then the date kind of running backwards. This A stands for January call options. More on that in a second. But this kind of goes backwards. This is January 21st. Of the year 2022, and then your strike price of 100. And that contains everything you need to know: the stock symbol, the exact expiration date with the month, the identifier of call or put, and then the strike price. And as I said, this A, you might see this from time to time or at from various data providers. It's far more likely that you're going to get a more crystal clear identification of what the option is with the month spelled out. You know, January might be spelled out or abbreviated, and then some identifier might have a C or a P for call or put, or just might have, you know, calls on the left, puts on the right, and you can view it that way. But it is still interesting to see how the industry has identified this. I said A would tell me January calls, and it's a fairly simple system that is going to run just alphabetically. A through L is all call options, and they identify not just calls, but what month the expiration date is in. And that's A through L. That's the symbology there. And then over on the put side, you just pick it up with M through X. M through X are all put options, and each individual letter will attach itself to a particular month. So if the example I gave was XYZ 2221 X100, this would be the stock XYZ, and it would be the December put option expiring on the 21st of the year 2022 at the 100 strike. So December puts, if it said X, and that's where that those letters come from and what they are attached to. Going back to 2010, not too long ago, but the industry, you know, it's trying to unify the way symbols were presented for ease of use of the investor. And I had mentioned that there's contract adjustments, there's adjusted symbols, and there's flex. So let's talk about flex for a little bit. The exchanges list options and will decide for themselves not only what companies get options, but what expirations are going to exist and what strike prices are going to exist, and list those options for trading. Sometimes an investor, or maybe more likely a bank or an institution, might be looking for something different. They want their own expiration date, which the exchange isn't listing. Or they want a different strike price that the exchange isn't listing. And the system of using flex options is the exchange providing the investor with the opportunity to proactively customize their own option and go to the exchange and say, look, on this particular symbol, I'd like an expiration date that's different from what you have, a strike price that's different. Here's the option I'm looking for. Can you give me a bid and an offer? And then the exchange will solicit bids and offers from market makers and professionals. If one of these options trades and it now exists, then it will get a symbol that has a numeric prefix. And that's what these examples are, 1XYZ or 4ZYX. The numeric prefix identifies that this is a flex option. And the numeric prefix is going to be either 1, 2, 3, or 4. If it's an equity option, it's only going to be either 1 or 2. Equity or ETF options, which are physically settled, can either be American or European if they are a flex. And index options, which are largely cash settled, can not only be American or European, they also can be either AM or PM. And the investor that created this option can decide which of these would they like their flex option to be, and then the corresponding number becomes the numeric prefix. A little bit more about this AM, PM. As I said, equity options, they're physically settled into shares. If you exercise a call, you pay your strike price, you get the shares back. Now, why is this AM, PM here? Because the cash settled index options don't deliver shares. There are not shares to deliver on SPX. There are shares on SPY, the ETF, but the index of SPX, for example, doesn't have shares. Instead, there is a cash settlement. The formula is used to calculate an index settlement value, and then options are settled against that number. A call option holder will just receive the cash difference for an in-the-money option, or for out-of-the-money just expires worthless. And AM options will take all of the opening prices in each of the companies in the index to use in their calculation. PM settled options for index products will take the closing prices of each entity, each stock in their index, run those numbers through the calculation, and that is the settlement value used to compare to the strike price, which would then determine in the money status and cash payment if the options are then in the money. So some differences there between equity and index options. A little bit further on listing, and we've covered a few times that the exchanges decide what stocks are going to get options, what expirations are going to exist. Well, back in the day, going back some years ago, decades ago, you know, the industry came up with a system of cycles. Every stock that has options is placed into one of these three cycles and will either be identified as cycle 1, 2, or 3, or otherwise known as the January, February, or March cycle. Now, every stock that has options is going to have at least 4 expiration months. Going back again to the traditional system from way back in the 70s, the traditional expiration day is the third Friday of the month. And up until recently, it was actually identified as the Saturday following the third Friday of the month. They needed that extra day to process expiration exercises and assignment notices. That extra day is not needed anymore. About a handful of years ago, that was dropped. options now officially expire on their expiration day, which is the third Friday of the month. So again, going back to back through history, the stocks that have options have four expiration months. Every single option that is listed, you know, you'll have two near-term consecutive calendar months. So the first 2 months, every single stock is going to have expirations there. And then add to it the next two farther term that corresponds to the quarterly cycle. And I'll have an example on the next slide that clears that up a little bit. So that's how you get to those four. Every stock gets the front 2 months. And then the next 2 months after that depend on what cycle it's in. And the reason, again, the reason why this was in place in decades ago was to relieve the burden on technology and not have all options using the same months that go out over time. Of course, in today's world, the most frequently traded securities have a lot more than just these four. We now have LEAPs, we have weeklies, and you have a vast amount of options that are available to trade. The exchanges really just try to provide investors what they're looking for. If there's demand to trade options, the exchange wants to give it to you. And that's why this has expanded so much over the years, especially recently, to include far more than just these 4 months. However, you might find yourself in a position of trading a particular stock that only has these 4 months, and it's useful to know what these cycles are. Let's look at that example that will clear it up and say that XYZ is a cycle two option. That's just something the exchange has identified it as cycle two, put it in that group, and it is currently December. And there's only 4 months. That's what this option, this stock is going to get, 4 months of expirations. Which months are available right now? And when December expires, what's going to be added next? So we said the first 2 months are going to exist. The two near months of December and January are going to trade. That's true for all securities. Now, what are the next two? After January, the first two on the list here, February and May. So this cycle two XYZ stock is going to be trading December, January, February, and May. If it was a cycle one, it would have December, January, and then the next two, April and July. And if it was a cycle three, it would have December and January, just like all the rest. And then the next two on the list, March and June. And that's how it works. When the front month expires, then another month is added, and you'll still have to have two near-term months and then two far-term months. Back to our cycle two example, when December expires, we need to have January and February. That's what every stock needs. We already have January. We already have February. We've already got May. Next on the list is August. For cycle two, it's August. So that's what will be added after December expires. Now, as you get symbols that trade a lot more frequently, this can be somewhat difficult to determine what's going to come on next because there's so much more than just these front 4 months. But this is the baseline. This is where it all starts from. And for those securities that don't have as much volume or interest, you might pop up a quote screen and just see 4 months. And now you know where that comes from. That's where the industry started at. And these cycles are going to be used to determine what expirations exist in the future as you move forward. So taking this from cycles, and now let's get into the options chains and look at this a little bit more deeply. You know, first of all, what are options chains? Really just a plethora of data, an array of information that details all of the options that are listed and available for trading in a particular security. And then within that, you can further scrutinize the available strike prices, expiration dates, and then what's usually a customizable set of data, sometimes including the bid-ask market size, the volume, open interest, and I'll have comments on those today as well, implied volatility, Greeks, the TradeStation platform, and whatever platform you've got that you're using is probably going to have a default list of criteria and data points it's going to list, and then you can go in and change that around and delete some and add some to your liking. And knowing what's available to you is important because maybe that default is not what you're looking for, and you can get a little bit better data by changing that. And of course, you can find these on trading sites, free quotes pages, but certainly TradeStation platform, which will, by the way, have much more robust data and far greater analytics than you would get on the OIC quotes page. But for the purpose of our presentation here, the snapshots that I've got are from the optionseducation.org website. And let's take a look at one to see what an options chain will look like. You type in your symbol up top. Our quotes on our site are 20 minutes delayed. And you have your symbol up top and then your data here that really is mostly related to stock, the last trade in the stock, its change on the day, and then some stock information and average total open interest we've got on our website. So this is your data to start with. And then from there, you can further customize the result. What options might you be looking for? You know, at the money only, at the money and out of the money only. Maybe you're looking for in the monies, and this is a way to reduce that long list of strike prices you might be looking at. We also have an ability here to filter selecting near the money and how many strikes are you looking for. Type in a number there, go, and then your expiration date. And the result here is going to be your options chain, a full long list of strike prices with the bid ask mean. I'll have more to say about that when we get to order entry here in a second, volume, open interest, and then your Greeks on the right side. Again, all this customizable. If you want to add some things or move some things and move them around, that's something that you can do and look into to get this set up the way you want it. Implied volatility highlighted on our website with all the Greeks. Of course, the big ones, delta, gamma, theta, vega, rho. We have alpha here. That's not something I hear about too often. Alpha is a second order Greek, which those second order Greeks really are an attempt to identify Greeks' relationships to each other. And alpha in particular is the changes in gamma as time changes. So a gamma theta relationship, that's what alpha is. But a second order derivative is what that is, just highlighting that they exist. But the top Greeks here, those five, and then implied volatility levels, which of course attach themselves to each option running through the formula and the last trade, and each strike, each option getting its own unique implied volatility level. Again, this is the way it would look on our site, but brokerage platforms and TradeStation's platforms are going to have a much more user-friendly, easier to use, and robust set of data. Let's look at order types and have a few comments there. A little bit of options 101, back to the basics. You know, buying to open is a purchase transaction to create or to add more to a long options position. Buying to close is reducing your position. A purchase transaction to exit or reduce an options position that was short or open and short. And then you have the similar terminology here. Sell to open is when you don't have a position or you are short and you're selling more. A sale transaction to create a new or add to a short options position. Selling to close follows buys to open. You buy to open, and then if you want to close it, you are selling to close, a sale transaction. So buying or selling is just what you're doing. Are you buying this option or are you selling it? And then the second piece is this opening a new position that doesn't exist already or add to one that already exists? Or are you closing? Are you reducing down a position that already exists? And that's what those four terms mean. Order types, you know, the exchanges identify what kind of order types they're willing to accept. There's certainly a long list of different complex orders that can vary from one exchange to the next. But most investors are going to use simply market orders and limit orders. Market order is placed to immediately buy or sell at the best price available. Whatever there is, that's where you're going to get executed. It's somewhat entering an order in a blind fashion. You can check what the bid ask is, but this order does not have any restrictions on price. You're just going to get filled on whatever that price is. I've heard the analogy, it's kind of like ordering seafood at a restaurant at market price. You don't know what it is. The menu's not telling you what it is. You order it and you pay whatever the bill comes back at. You just get filled at that price. Limit order specifies what the price is. So you're looking to buy or sell in this case, options we're looking at a specific price, and you will not get filled at a worse price. Market orders get filled at whatever price is there. Limit orders restrict price and don't guarantee that you'll get filled. If you're looking at the bid ask, and we'll just focus on the top line here, this 311 call option, the mean is a really nice reference to use. The between the bid ask, you've got the mean. And from here, if you're looking to buy this option, the mean can represent your starting point, and then you determine from there, how aggressive do you want to be to get into this options contract? Of course, having some familiarity and some intimate knowledge of how these options trade on a particular stock, because all stocks are different, would be helpful. If you put in the order here to buy at 455, would you get filled there or not? You may already have an opinion on that. The more aggressive you want to be buying the option, the higher you can get to 457. In fact, if you want to be very aggressive, but you don't like market orders, you can go through the offer and you could place a limit order to buy this option, say at $4.60. And if that ask is good at 457, then you can expect to hopefully get filled there at 457 or maybe 458. You won't take any worse than 460, but you're aggressively trying to get in at 457. And that brings me to my next comment. Something we don't have on our website is the bid ask size. Right next to it in a different column here on your chains, you could have bid size and ask size. This might be 452 bid, and there's 20 contracts being bid, 452. The ask here might be 457. There might be only one contract being offered at 457. If you went in with a market order to buy five contracts at 457, you're going to get one for sure at 457. The other four, you don't know. Maybe 457, maybe 460, maybe $5. You don't know where the rest of those four are going to come from. A limit order, however, is going to set where the price is going to be. It's going to set a restriction. You're going to buy five contracts. You're going to pay 460. Well, it'd be nice to know what size is here. If there's only one, you may want to just put that in at 457. Buy the one and work the other four. Maybe get filled right away. Maybe you have to wait on it. Or go ahead and pay up to 460. But if you only see one here and you're buying five, then you can expect a strong possibility that if you just put in a market order, you're going to get filled on one, and the rest are going to be at a higher price. Also, market orders will get filled wherever the price is at that time. If you got stale market, stale quotes, then that can cause a problem for you. So limit orders can be used in a variety of ways, and the most aggressive is just to go through the ask. If you really want to buy something, go to a higher price, looking to get filled on the ask, giving yourself a few pennies of cushion there to the upside. Now, a few other things to walk through. First of all, open interest. I get questioned a lot about open interest. Investor might say, do I want to trade any contracts that don't have a significant amount of open interest? And it's an interesting question to ask. Well, let's just first clarify what open interest is. It is the total number of open contracts carried over from the close of business, let's say yesterday, to today. Open interest that you see on your platform today represents yesterday's close of business. And some investors might look at that to identify where is the interest? Where is the investing community looking at as far as strike price and what they might be expecting for future moves in the stock? A little math here behind it. When there is an options transaction, we covered earlier, there's four ways that can go, and they are either buy or sell, and they're open or closed. So there's different combinations. If the buy is to open and the sell is also to open, then open interest increases by one. And down on the bottom here, if the buy order is to close and the sell order is to close, then the open interest decreases by one. And if there's an open versus a close in either direction, you have no change. So what you can see clearly here is a couple things. First of all, if this is where open interest comes from, open to open transactions, then every time a market, an option gets listed, it's going to have an open interest of zero. Even the most liquid options out there, when a new expiration date is listed, all of those options have an open interest of zero. That doesn't mean that you can't trade them. Also, you know, keeping with respect to open interest changing, and what this will tell you is that you can have a lot of volume change on the day, but if they're open versus closes, you may see open interest do absolutely nothing. So a lot of volume, a lot of activity might not result in changes in open interest. And that's really where I somewhat point investors to when they're looking at liquidity and their ability to get in and out of an options contract. It really is the bid, the ask, the quality, or the how tight that bid ask is, and then the bid size and the ask size and the depth there. If you're seeing size bids, size offers, every penny on out and looking at that depth, then that is where the liquidity will come from. Open interest can be a bit misleading. Now, you might look at open interest in a different way. If stock's trading at 100 and you see tremendous open interest at the 150 strike, you might interpret yourself that some entity or institution is very bullish and is buying cheap, deep out of the money calls, and that's where that is coming from. But remember, you don't always know why options trade. They could be speculating, they could be hedging a different position, they could be spread off against something else. You don't really know exactly what's going on. So look at open interest for what it's worth, but make sure you don't look too deeply in it and misinterpret it with respect to how you make trading decisions. Now I want to do something a little bit different. You know, I'll sometimes pose a question to the audience about what their account looks like. Now, of course, every investor is looking at their account and they're tracking changes that occur in their account, as you should. But it's pretty common to not look at every line item and understand everything that goes into it. And options certainly add a layer of complexity. And one question that I'll pose an audience when I give a presentation might be, well, let's start with an option. Say the June 35 puts quoted 275 bid at 285. Let's say we sell two of these June 35 puts at 275. And hypothetically, let's fast forward out to June expiration and say these options expire worthless. The question is, when will you notice the $550 profit that you should have experienced in your account? When are you going to see that total overall account balance change? And in response to that question, maybe it's a knee-jerk response, and a lot of investors will say you'll see that right away. You'll see that immediately when you sell the option, thinking that when you sell an option, you get paid right away. So you should see your account balance go up right away. And that's not true. That's not the way it works. If you sold this option, you sold each one for $275, you sold two of them, you got $550, your cash position is going to go up by $550. But this short option position is going to go into your account as a debit because you're short. If you're going to close, you're going to have to buy it back. Your platform is likely going to read the best available price to you to buy it back. In this case, $285. It would cost you $570 to buy back this option that you received $554. So at the initial trade, as soon as you make this trade, your account balance might drop a little bit by 20. That could be more magnified if you're doing a higher priced option or doing more contracts. You might see that immediate drop. And I've heard that comment from investors saying, I just sold this option a minute ago. Nothing's changed and my account balance is already showing a loss. And it is, but it's not really a loss. It's the difference between what you received and the best price available. If you did this the other way, same thing would happen. If you bought the option for $285, you would pay that cash out. Now you own something. Your brokerage firm is likely going to value what you own at the best price you can sell it for, which is here, $275. And your account balance would then drop by the difference in this spread. And that's likely something close to what you will see in your account when you make this trade. Now let's move this forward and say 3 weeks goes by and the market for this put option is moving in our favor. It's dropped. Now it's 155 bid at 165. Well, the cash position in our account never changed. We received 550 in cash up front. That's fixed. But now the market, the short position, which is a variable, is changing. We're now looking at an option whose best offer is 165. The debit position in our account is now 330, and our account balance has gradually increased and is now showing a profit of 220. Again, not all in one day or in one moment. Gradually over time, it got here. And then if you keep going and say that we've reached June expiration, the 35 put is worthless, now you still got the cash. There's no option position, so no debit here at all. And your account balance has gradually and slowly increased by $550. And you've recognized this profit. You just don't see it all at once. You don't see it right away. It takes some time to get there. And again, this same process would occur if you bought an option. It would work the same way. As the option value increases, what you own would increase in value. If it decreases, what you own goes down in value, and your account balance fluctuates based off of the change in the position, while your cash is either a fixed debit or a fixed credit. So hopefully that clears up a little bit for those of you who might be not looking at all of the details, just looking at the bottom line. That's how that works. And then I want to finish up with contract adjustments, because this can be a really confusing topic for investors. If there is a corporate action of some kind, and then this could include stock splits, maybe special dividends, distributions, mergers, bankruptcies, buyouts could occur. If something changes with the structure of the shares, and you can think of it this way, you know, every option delivers 100 shares of stock. If a corporate action results in those 100 shares changing into something else, then the options contract may need to adjust contract adjustments and change and become something different. And the result of these corporate actions, you know, could change the option symbol and change in the components. Maybe the deliverable, for example, changes, and 100 shares of stock was now bought out for a fixed amount of cash. You don't have shares, you have cash. And now the options is something different. Now these symbols are going to vary depending on what type of action this is, or how many corporate actions have taken place. But as earlier I said, there's a numeric suffix. For flex options, there was a numeric prefix. Here for contract adjustments, there's a numeric suffix at the end of the symbol. So XYZ1, XYZ2, XYZ3, there's no limit on how high that number can go. A numeric suffix will indicate that there is a change or an adjusted contract. Be very careful there, because sometimes an option can appear to be in the money and trading for a very cheap amount. And like you've heard many times in many different capacities, if something looks too good to be true, it probably is. And you need to be careful about that. Sometimes you can have adjustments occur, and that quick math of looking at a strike price versus the open market stock value, it won't work to determine in the money status. It is possible to see a call option with a strike price of 10 with the stock trading at 15, and that option might be deep out of the money because of changes, because of corporate actions, changes in symbol, changes in the deliverable. And again, that numeric suffix is going to be your tip off in what that is all about. I mentioned reverse stock splits. You know, those come up from time to time, especially when you have catastrophic declines in either the market or specific industries, like we saw with energy markets. Some of those ETFs went through reverse splits, and that affects the options contracts, of course. Won't get into too many details there, but one thing to point out is that options contracts need to adjust on a per contract basis. Different from holding a large amount of shares in your account, where the total amount of shares can be adjusted as a whole, options are adjusted on a per contract basis. Meaning if you hold 10 options, each one of those is going to adjust. There won't be an adjustment made with consideration to your total position of 10. If you've gone through this before, that would make more sense, and you might see what I mean by that. But options are fungible. You can buy or sell one contract. You can exercise one contract, and someone on the other side can get assigned on one contract. Therefore, adjustments need to be made at that lowest common denominator of one contract. It could be confusing to go through this. That's why the investor services team there at OCC is there to help. Investorservices@theocc.com. This is what they do. They go through contract adjustments constantly, and they are your resource if you do want to reach out with questions about contract adjustments. So there you have it. Again, any other questions you have about options, the investor services team is there to help you out. And that covers some of the common questions today, as I wanted to get through kind of bouncing around to different topics, looking at quotes and chains, reading symbology, a little bit about your account statement, and then some flex and contract adjustments as well. Hope you found that useful. And Michael, that is what I had for today. So I will turn it back to you to wrap it up.
Thank you very much, Ed. That was great as always. Thanks everybody for joining us. Ed will be back with us in June for another one of these events, and make sure you check out YouTube to look at all of the past events that Ed has done with us, along with all of the other archive videos from all of the events that we do here at TradeStation. So thanks everybody for joining us, and we'll see you again at another upcoming TradeStation event. Have a great evening, everyone. Thanks again.